Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine inaugural class of 2018 White Coat Ceremony. The program is about to begin. We ask that you remain seated throughout today's ceremony. If you need to leave the auditorium, please exit using the back corner door through which you entered. The ceremony is being videotaped and broadcast live via the medical school website. A professional photographer will be taking photos during the ceremony. These will be available to the students to share with family and friends. We ask that you do not approach the center aisle or the stage to take personal photos, as this may disrupt the presentation of the white coats. Thank you for your cooperation. With music performed by the Kalamazoo Symphony Orchestra Burdick Thorne String Quartet, we welcome today's speakers, the Learning Community Scholar Advisors, and the inaugural class of 2018. Please be seated.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Peter Zimkowski, Associate Dean for Student Affairs, and it's my privilege to be your host. On behalf of Dean Hal Jensen, the Medical School Associate Deans, Assistant Deans, Department Chairs, and faculty, it's my honor to welcome you all and to thank you for joining us today for this momentous occasion. We're pleased to have almost 400 guests, including family members and friends of our medical students. Some of you have traveled from locations across the U.S. to be here with us. As you can see, every seat in the auditorium is taken. We have more guests viewing the ceremony from the skyboxes above us and in the first floor TBL hall. We're also streaming the ceremony live on our medical school website, which enables loved ones and friends who could not be here to be part of the special day from afar. First, I'd like to introduce Dr. David Overton, Associate Dean for Educational Affairs, to share the history of the White Coat and the White Coat Ceremony.
Thank you, Dr. Zimkowski, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The White Coat, the Doctor's Black Bag, the Stethoscope, the Oath of Hippocrates, a snake-entwined staff called the Caduceus. These are all symbols of the medical profession. In the middle of the 19th century, the medical profession, which previously had worn almost entirely black, turned to science to provide advances in curing disease. At that same time, physicians also adopted the scientific lab coat as their standard attire. Originally, those lab coats were beige, but when adopted by the medical profession, white was chosen. The color white, representing cleanliness and purity, is a visual reminder of our commitment to do no harm, including infectious disease harm. The white coat symbolizes our seriousness of purpose and our compassion. Today, whenever we see the media depict the medical profession, the most common accessory adorning a physician is a white coat. In 1993, the Arnold P. Gold Foundation and physicians at Columbia University initiated the first white coat ceremony. Since then, this ceremony has been adopted by almost every medical school, both in the U.S. and abroad. The white coat ceremony is intended to welcome entering medical students and help them establish a psychological contract with the profession of medicine. The Arnold P. Gold Foundation works with healthcare professionals in training and in practice to instill a culture of respect, of dignity, and of compassion for patients and professionals. The foundation's logo is a heart-shaped stethoscope. That same logo is featured on a lapel pin that has been placed on the white coats that you will be cloaked with during our ceremony today. The white coat, as a symbol of one of medicine's most important symbol, signifies, in the words of Dr. Gold, a physician's responsibility is not only to take care of patients, but also to care for patients. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome Dr. Elizabeth Burns. Dr. Burns is the Associate Dean for Faculty and Clinical Affairs. Dr. Burns.
Thank you, Dr. Overton, and good afternoon, everyone. It is my honor to speak on behalf of our medical school faculty, which includes more than 500 clinicians, educators, and researchers. We have the responsibility of guiding you, our medical students, in your search for excellence in medical education, patient care, research, and service. It is not only our responsibility, but also our privilege and honor to provide you with the best at every learning opportunity. We are here to serve as your teachers, mentors, guides, advisors, and counselors in a collegial and supportive environment. We officially welcome you into the medical school community today. For the next 4 years, you will be medical students, but as that time quickly passes, you will become physicians, residents, fellows, and colleagues. Today, you will be presented with your white coat by a faculty member, your learning community scholar advisor. As background for our guests, WMed students are organized as members of learning communities, which enhance learning by promoting professional, next page, professional and social interactions among and between classes. Students learn from each other through these associations and collaborations, similar to how physicians learn from their colleagues throughout their careers. Each learning community has guidance from designated clinician educators serving in the role of scholar advisor. The scholar advisor teaches clinical skills as part of the curriculum and provides mentoring to the students in a learning community. Because of the important role that they fulfill, the scholar advisors have a very special opportunity to get to know our students, perhaps better than any other faculty member. Students, when the scholar advisor presents you with your white coat today, know that they represent all faculty members who support you, welcome you, and have confidence and faith that you will become dedicated physicians, true to your oath, and a credit to the profession. I'd like now to introduce Dr. Hal Jensen, founding dean of Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine. Dean Jensen.
Thank you, Dr. Burns. Today's inaugural white coat ceremony is another momentous first for the medical school, and I thank all of you for joining us in this celebration. The white coat ceremony is a rite of passage for new students as they enter medical school. Today, we present you, members of the class of 2018, with your white coat, the most recognized symbol of the medical profession. For your clinical experiences, which begin next week, we expect that you will wear your white coat as part of your professional attire. Wearing the white coat is not only an expectation, but a privilege. As you recite the 2018 Medical Student Oath, which you as a class have composed, remember the words that you pledge today before each other, the medical school faculty, your family and friends, the community, and your future patients. Today's ceremony and oath-taking is much more than a ritual. You are setting expectations and instilling values in yourself that you pledge to keep. Your role in the doctor-patient relationship has already begun as you learn the science of medicine and master the practice of patient care. A physician must care as well as cure. As a physician, you are obligated to demonstrate excellence in the mastery of scientific knowledge, to be compassionate, and to embody those lifelong values of integrity, professionalism, and lifelong learning. We, the faculty and administration of Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine, pledge to fulfill our mission, our promise to you, to educate and inspire each of you to become the exceptional clinicians, leaders, educators, advocates, and researchers of tomorrow. It is my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker. Dr. Alan Shapiro is Assistant Clinical Professor in the Department of Pediatrics at Albert Einstein College of Medicine and Senior Medical Director for Community Pediatric Programs located in New York City's South Bronx. Community Pediatric Programs is a collaboration between the Children's Hospital at Montefiore and the Children's Health Fund. Its programs include a mobile-based homeless health care program serving children, families, and others in New York City's shelter system since 1987. A federally qualified community health center in the South Bronx serving the nation's poorest congressional district since 1993, and for which Dr. Shapiro was the first medical director, and a mobile-based dental health clinic since 2011. He's also the director for the Center for Preventive Health and Special Initiatives, dedicated to closing gaps in health disparities through the development of innovative best practice models of care in community-based settings. The center's had a number of recent publications in peer-reviewed journals and is presented widely at national conferences. Dr. Shapiro is a pediatrician who's dedicated his career to the care of vulnerable children. He has extensive experience working with underserved and marginalized pediatric populations, such as the homeless, street-involved youth, inner-city youth, and immigrant children. Additionally, Dr. Shapiro's had extensive involvement in disaster relief efforts over the past 20 years, leading medical teams in the aftermath of Hurricanes Andrew, Katrina, and Sandy, and in New York City after 9/11. Dr. Shapiro's worked internationally on medical missions, serving as the pediatric team leader for missions in Peru and Ecuador. More recently, Dr. Shapiro was elected the 2012 recipient of the Children's Health Fund Founders Award, with which he co-founded Terra Firma, a health and justice program for immigrant children. This medical legal partnership care program has gained national attention in providing care that includes medical care, psychosocial support, and legal services for newly arrived immigrant children who are unaccompanied from Central America. It is our honor to have Dr. Shapiro join us today, and I welcome you to the medical school.
Wow, thank you very much. I can't believe what an honor it is to be here, and I feel quite nervous because this is such a special day for all of you, and I want to live up to that expectation. I'm here really because Dr. Dixon and I belong to a network called the Children's Health Fund, who provides health care to children, really some of the most marginalized children in the country, in urban and rural settings out of mobile medical units. So our clinic is a clinic on wheels. And Dr. Dixon was so nice to invite me today and to give me this honor. So it is a very historic day for all of you. This is your first white coat ceremony here at the medical school, brand new class. It's the first white coat ceremony for me too. And it made me reflect on my first day of medical school, and which was pre-cell phone, pre-computer. I remember getting dressed for school and hearing Madonna's Borderline. And there was no white coat ceremony back then, so times have really changed. So I've been asked to give this talk on humanism and humanism in medicine, and it's such a lofty topic. You know, how am I going to do this in 20 minutes? I mean, maybe humanism is only having lecturers speak for 20 minutes. Actually, Dr. Dixon has a big 5-minute sign, so when I'm starting to go too long, she's going to put it up. So the idea of humanism in medicine is really an ancient one from the 3rd century BC. So it's kind of amazing that we're still talking about this now, right? So, you know, what have we learned? Do we need this? In the Hippocratic Oath from 300 and some odd BC, it says, and I think this sums up a lot, I will remember that there is an art to medicine as well as the science, and that warmth, sympathy, and understanding may outweigh the surgeon's knife or the chemist's drug. That was true then, and it's true today. So why are we still talking about this so many centuries later? I guess the Arnold P. Gold Foundation, realized that what doctors care about is science, and what they're focused on is science, and that they're not focused necessarily on the human interaction of science. And they dedicated their mission to making sure that we all don't forget that. Hippocrates also said in the oath that we should combat social injustice whenever we see it. So while I'm talking to you today about how you are going to practice medicine and how you're going to care for your patients, the micro, I want you also to think about your work and how there are issues of inequality in the system that you're going to come across really almost every day you work, the macro level. We can't be compassionate to our patients if they can't come into our door. Some of the worst health disparities exist because people don't have access to us. But I have a feeling what you're here today, what you're thinking about is, oh my God, I got to learn diseases, I got to learn how to diagnose them, and I have to learn to treat them. Of course, that's what you're here, and that's what you're thinking. And I was asking my colleagues, because I didn't go through a white coat ceremony, like, what do you remember about your white coat ceremony? And they were like, oh, there was really good drinks afterwards, and and I remember getting the white coat. And that's when one of our really cheeky nurses said to me, why don't you go up to the stage naked with a white coat on, and they'll totally remember you. So you'll remember me as the doctor who thought about going up to the stage naked with a white coat on. So in trying to figure out how am I going to do this today, which I struggled with, I have to tell you, I kind of came up with a recipe that is part lecture, part cautionary advice, part nurturing, and I hope a little bit of inspiration. So you're all embarking on this new career, and I don't want to frighten you, but your lives will never be the same again. And you can ask any doctor in this room, your lives will never be the same again. You're going to be learning so much. I mean, you are going to be working extremely hard. You're going to be sleep deprived. You're going to be eating the foods that you tell your patients every day not to eat. But you are going to be learning science, the art of medicine, and human behavior. And that is going to be a journey that really will never end. Your career, your lives will continually evolve throughout the next 4 years, and then thereafter, and thereafter. So some of you are going to go into private practice and practice in the poor inner cities of this country or poor rural areas. Some of you are going to go into private practice, be specialists, maybe in fancy offices. Some of you might just go into research. And it doesn't matter. It's all good. But I'm here to tell you, it's not about what you do, what you practice. It's about how you do it. And this lecture is to talk about how you could put humanism into your practice and how you can, no matter what you do, be a human being. Simply put, humanism means that we all treat each other like equals. When a patient comes into your office, you're treating them like you would want to be treated yourself. We're not better than our patients. We're definitely different. Doctors are different, but we're not better, and we have to remember that. So I would be remiss if I, this is the teaching part, if I didn't talk about the key elements about how we practice humanism. And you can find this in the Arnold P. Gold website, but I thought it was a good framework for sort of discussing how to think about humanism and how to practice it. So the key elements, what we could say the gold standard, is integrity. So the expression of your values matching your behavior. So not just walk the walk, talk the talk. And if we think about that globally in the whole system, you know, it makes you wonder about the integrity of our healthcare system when we are arguing every day about whether to give people health insurance. I mean, how crazy is that? So do we have healthcare integrity in this country? Hopefully you will have it in your practice. Excellence of clinical care. You have to be a kind doctor, but you want to be a really smart one too. So you have to learn the science. Compassion, the awareness and acknowledgement of suffering, and the desire to relieve it. Now, a lot of that suffering will be very visible to all of you. You will see it in the hospital wards, you'll see it in your clinic office. But there's actually a lot of suffering that's invisible, and I kind of feel like that is maybe the most important thing for me to tell you today. So for me, the invisibility of suffering falls in the area of social injustice. And what we like to say now, and what we talk about now in medicine, especially in primary care medicine, are the social determinants of health. So beyond the actual physiology of the body, what are the aspects in people's lives that are affecting their health? You know, they bring lawyers now into clinics because there's some things that can't be solved with medicine. A lawyer's letter to a landlord that says you have to fix the apartment so that this child is not suffering from asthma and ending up in the emergency room every day, no matter how much you maximize their medicines, that's a social determinant of health. When you see your patients, you have to say to yourself, are they homeless? Do they have a home? Do they have food insecurity? Are they discriminated against? Do they have health insurance? These are all things that will absolutely impact the patients you see. So Dr. Jensen mentioned this new program that we started called Terra Firma. Terra Firma was set up to be a medical legal partnership clinic for unaccompanied immigrant children coming across the country, across our border. And these are children that are refugees, many who have suffered unspeakable harm in their home countries. And when I read in the paper the not in my backyard attitude towards these kids, I mean, I am astounded. So when we talk about compassion, for me, it's like a big red light that goes off. Altruism, putting others' interests in front of yours. I knew I'd mess up somewhere. And, you know, I would also go so far as to say that's not only with your patients, but with your colleagues and the people you work with. Okay, here comes a big one, respect. The regard for the autonomy and values of others. I think practicing humanism in medicine is, I think this idea of respect and kind of letting your patients, understanding your patients, respecting their point of view in the practice of medicine is probably maybe the biggest key point, the biggest key element here that I'm talking about today. So you're going to have patients that do not follow your advice. You're going to have patients that actually contradict your advice. You're going to have patients whose behavior you're going to be astounded by. Someone with cirrhosis who continues to drink, someone who has cancer and continues to smoke. What do you do? Do you just completely say, I wash my hands of you? So the idea of respect is, and really the art of medicine is to learn how to respect patients even when you don't agree with their decisions and their behavior. And I think that is maybe one of the most important decisions today. And it's learning how to communicate with patients, learning why they do what they do that's so important. Remember, you know, many of you are very young. I mean, people are gonna see you with years of experience, years of beliefs and life experience that they're bringing into your office. You have to trust that. You have to believe that. You have to understand that they're making decisions because of their experience. Couple of examples. I had a mom who came into my clinic the other day, and her daughter was coughing. She had asthma, and she smelled of cigarette smoke, and she actually had lung cancer. And I was astounded. I can't say, stop, don't come here. I have to say, why are you smoking? I have to understand where she's coming from. I work with homeless street kids. I have a young man who uses crystal meth, lives on the street, and engages in unprotected sex. And I say, you're gonna get HIV, you're gonna get sick. He says, that's nothing compared to what I've been through. So you have to understand where the patient is coming from. I think the key to this is not a practice of non-judgment. So we're putting on a white coat, we're not putting on a black robe. And I think that's really important to remember. Empathy, putting yourself in other people's position. So you're gonna be seeing patients that look very different than you, that are completely come from another world. And how can you put yourself in their shoes to understand their experience? So when you practice medicine, you will understand what they've gone through. There's a great book by Andrew Solomon called Not Far From the Tree. And I really encourage you to read it because you will see how empathy, you know, the sort of the nth degree of empathy, when a parent has a child that is so different than them, so a child that's born with autism or a child that has no hearing when they're a hearing parent, and how they have to bridge that relationship. It's incredibly important lessons for all of us when we read that book. And lastly, service. So sharing your talent, sharing your knowledge with folks who don't have it. And I know Dr. Dixon was telling me about the program and how it's developed and how you're going to be working in the community. And I think that's really fabulous. And I think those are going to be life-changing experiences for you. There's a book about the very famous Dr. Paul Farmer called Mountains Beyond Mountains. And I'd put it on your reading list because when we talk about service, about using your knowledge, your genius in his case, to bring services and healthcare to people who wouldn't have it, it's a really incredible, incredible story. So this is humanism. You have to make it your own. This has to be personalized. You're not gonna get this right away. It's gonna take years to form. And don't worry about it. I mean, that's the worst part. It's like, oh my God, this is so much pressure. Don't worry about it, you will get it. But just remind yourselves of this. When things are going really rough with a patient, remind yourselves about this. So I went into medicine because for me, I was a kid of the 60s, and you know, I was living at the end of the Vietnam War, there was the civil rights movement that was going on. I guess some could say it's still going on. And for me, medicine was not so much giving back, but getting back. And I remember, you know, my earliest experiences of social injustice were driving to my grandfather's house, apartment in the Bronx, along the Cross Bronx Expressway, and along the expressway are buildings with painted facades of window curtains and flower pots. And I'd say to my parents, you know, what is that? Why, you know, why are these windows covered? And my parents said, because they don't want us to see the poverty. That had a huge impact on me. As a medical student, I went to work in Peru, and I had really an amazing experience working in the slums of Lima. Again, really sort of changed my life, because there I worked in the field. I was going into people's homes. So when I was in residency and I had a chance to work on this mobile medical unit to go to homeless shelters, it felt very similar to me. It was like, I'm there where people are living. These are people that we blame a lot for their health conditions, but I'm seeing where they're living. You know, I'm going to a shelter out by Kennedy Airport in the middle of an industrial park where children are living. In 1987, there was 10,000 children living in homeless shelters. Today, there's about 23,000 children living in homeless shelters in New York City. I mean, it is astounding. So our battles are clearly not over. I was very lucky. In 1993, we were able to open a health center in the South Bronx. And at that point, you know, the South Bronx was, it's kind of, in my mind, like post-Katrina. It was like, all the rubble, all the burned buildings were all cleared. There was empty lots everywhere. It's probably not unlike some of the cities, you know, like Detroit or some of the other cities around this country today. And in fact, the only healthcare services that existed in the community was a local hospital, community hospital, that actually closed to become a homeless shelter that we actually service with our mobile unit. So we came into the neighborhood, and we had to connect with various community organizations just to let people know we were here. And the first program we connected to was a high school. And there was this amazing program for, it was sort of an exercise boot camp program for kids. They had to get there like at 5:30 in the morning. And so these kids were super motivated. And so they started sending their kids to us because they needed physicals, and there was nowhere else to go. And I had this patient, Juan, who came to see me, and he was just this bright, happy kid. He grew up with a mom who was, Juan himself was a Honduran immigrant, and his mom was an immigrant who worked two jobs. She worked construction and she worked housekeeping, and was raising four children alone. And she wasn't around that much. And Juan started coming to see me like all the time. I was like, Juan, you're fine. What are you here? And I started to realize that Juan needed an adult to talk to. And I could have said, Juan, listen, I'm busy. I have a lot of patients to see. Don't come here, you know. But I was fascinated by Juan. And then Juan started revealing to me that he wanted to be a doctor. Anyway, so time passes. Juan comes to my office one day and he says, you know, Dr. Allen, I'm dropping out of school. I'm gonna go work in a pizza parlor. I really have to help my mom. And I was totally devastated. And I was like, Juan, you are too bright. And so I said, let's make a deal. And we started this relationship. And I said, you come to see me, we'll figure out some of the problems in the home, but you have to stay in school. And so this idea of humanism allows us to open ourselves up for people. You know, that's the service part, going beyond what you're learning in medical school. You know, filling out a kid's college application if the parents don't know how to do it. Going to a soup kitchen, whatever. But that's what humanism means. So today you're putting on a white coat, and that white coat is a very powerful symbol. What it means to you is not going to be what it means to people on the other end of your stethoscope. For some, they'll respect you. Others will fear you. Many will question you. But a lot will need you and depend on you. And you want that white coat not to be a barrier, not to put a space between you and your patients. You have to say, when you put on that white coat, what do I want that to represent to the people I'm seeing today, to my patients? Do you want it to be a coat of armor, you know, where it keeps them at arm's distance? Or do you want it to be the soft arm, this white soft arm that they could put their hand on and say, thank you, and I understand, et cetera? I often think, you know, it's really interesting. Try practicing without a white coat and seeing what that effect is. And so I know I shouldn't be saying that today, but that's something you should try that. So the last part of my last part of this long-winded speech is I want to tell you to take care of yourself, okay? As medical students, as residents, as doctors, I think that's probably one of the most important messages I could give you today, starting out in your new career. This is going to be the most fascinating time of your life. You are going to be learning so much. But you will also be going through trials and tribulations. You will be going through a lot of self-doubt. You will have moments of, why did I go into this profession? What was I thinking? And I want to leave you with three messages. A, you are not alone. We have all gone through this, every one of us. You would not be humane. I would question your humanity if you did not feel that. Don't keep it inside. Critically important. You're feeling this, but so is everybody else. And unless you talk to each other, your mentors, your scholar advisors, it's gonna hurt you. Get it out. It'll be better for you. And really, everyone else is going through it. And you will be better for this. The last message, you will be a better doctor for going through all this. So I want to leave you with that. Take care of yourself. So I also know you're wondering about what happened to Juan, right? So I had a couple of tricks up my sleeve here. I only used some of them. So Juan ended up graduating high school. He went to an Ivy League school. He's an unbelievably bright kid. Applied to medical school, didn't get in. Worked at a couple of labs. I said, Juan, you got to keep doing this. You want to do this. Juan finally got into medical school. He got into Albert Einstein. Juan just finished his residency in family medicine, is now the chief resident in family medicine, and I'm hoping and crossing my fingers that next year Juan comes and joins our practice. I want to wish you all the very best of luck, and I only have one request, is that you invite me back to your graduation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Shapiro, for joining us to share your perspectives with our medical students and all of us here today, and hopefully we can have you back in 4 short years. Little less. Before we begin the presentation of the white coats, I'd like to acknowledge our white coat sponsors. The White Coat Sponsorship Program is a unique opportunity to engage the community as we welcome our medical students and as they embark on the path to becoming a physician. A white coat sponsor provided a financial contribution that funded a white coat, stethoscope, and scrubs for each student. In addition, each sponsor wrote a note of encouragement for their student, and that note has been placed in the pocket of the white coat that will be presented here today. Don't everybody look for it right now. So. Just prior to the ceremony today, the students had the opportunity to meet their white coat sponsor in person. Thank you to our sponsors for your support and commitments to our medical students. As we present the white coats, each row of students will be directed to stand and move to the side of the auditorium. The announcer will introduce the Learning Community Scholar Advisor who will perform the cloaking, and each student will be introduced as once he or she has arrived on the stage. You're welcome to clap and cheer as you see fit. No need to save your applause for the end. Show it now. But thank you for allowing the announcer to announce each student between your applause. Okay. And so.
Colleen Dodich, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Hussein Abadi. Kevin Cates. Zazu Rina Chen. Diana Fidraki. Cody Overmeyer. Andrew Sellis. Anna Villalobos. Rajiv Rangras, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Michael Behun. Amy Chong Hasawat. Rowan Kadar. Nguyen. William Rasmussen. Peter White. Eleanor Yu. Stephen Pollins, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Mackenzie Akers. Samarth Bondari. Jennifer Chow. John Livingstone. Jessica Ramsey. Tananom Shogi. Timothy Wisozin. Cynthia Bishara. Yen Yi Chen. Suthya Dulavai. Grant Finlayson. Nina Sadiq. Kevin Vox. Gus Zervodakis. Robert Rebar, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Nicole Baker. Jacob Brueger. Brian Chung. Alan Hifko. Daphne C. Lance von Brocht. Samuel Yost. Megan Guest, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Andrew Chen. Nicole Foley. Olivia Fournier. Tyler Harris. Mona Sonbol. Joshua Shinkowski. Ross Driscoll, MD, and Kevin Cavanaugh, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisors. Nicholas Beam. Heather Chen. Jacqueline Dauk. Eric Edward. Diti Ronvalier. Charles Srutowski. Michelle Walker. Brandy Shattuck, MD, Learning Community Scholar Advisor. Philip Bystrom. Patricia Choi. Jeffrey Johnson. Sheila Sullivan. Timothy Chuong. Garland Yu.
And now I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Cheryl Dixon, Associate Dean for Health, Equity, and Community Affairs. Dr. Dixon.
What a great day. As Dr. Overton mentioned earlier, in addition to the white coat, the oath of Hippocrates is a symbol of the medical profession. It perhaps is the most widely known of the Greek medical texts. It requires that the physician, new physicians, to swear upon the healing gods that he or she would uphold ethical standards. Over the centuries, it's been rewritten, often in order to suit the values of different cultures that have been influenced by Greek medicine. Contrary to proper belief, however, the oath does not explicitly contain the phrase, first do no harm, which was commonly attributed to the oath of Hippocrates. So what does a medical oath do? A medical oath declares the ethos of medicine. An oath includes a solemn promise that identifies the covenant relationship that exists between physicians, other healthcare providers, patients, and society. I had the opportunity, along with professions of medicine faculty in the Division of Ethics, Dr. Ross Driscoll, Dr. Michael Riedinger, and David Charlton from WMed Department of Philosophy, to work with the students to compose the class of 2018 medical student oath that will be recited today. The composition of the class oath was a student learning project that enabled them to work within their learning communities. I would like to also take the time to acknowledge the work of the four elected student representatives from each of those learning communities for their leadership and their teamwork and their dedication in putting together the oath for this class. They are Kevin Cates, Mackenzie Akers, Eric Edward, and Daphne C. They put in the effort. Then they came together for the whole class to finalize and approve the oath. Creation of their own class oath enables the students, it's important to do, because it allows them to reflect on the principles that they feel are important to embrace as future medical professionals, as well as students continuing for their 4 years. By writing their own words, the oath has more meaning for this class. At this time, I would ask the inaugural class of the medical students to stand. On the screen is the oath that they've written. It's also in the program. And I'd like you to now, in unison, recite your class oath. Now I would ask for you to face your audience. And I'd like for now to have the opportunity to present to you the inaugural class of 2018 for the Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine. I'd like now for Dr. Simkowski to come back to the podium, and you may have your seats.
Okay. Please remain seated while our inaugural class exits the auditorium. Thank you. all stay seated for just a few more moments? So the students are being escorted to the first floor lobby where a class photo is being taken in their white coats together for the first time. We will, of course, make this photo available to the students so they can share it with you, their family, and friends. I hope you can join us and the students for a reception that will be held throughout the first floor immediately following this ceremony. There are buffet tables located in the first floor corridor and the cafe areas near the front lobby. A celebratory cake and beverages are being served at the large reception desk adjacent to the cafe seating area. Please help yourself and enjoy. Also, this is your opportunity to take a self-guided tour of our new medical school facility. We opened this facility in mid-June after the completion of a $68 million construction project that included renovation and a new addition. You can explore the lower level simulation center as well as the first and second floors that include our two team-based learning halls, large and small classrooms, group rooms, fitness center, information commons, and a student learning communities. We have provided floor maps and plans for your reference. We also acknowledge and thank the Arnold P. Gold Foundation for providing a grant to establish our first white coat ceremony. Thank you to the Kalamazoo Symphony Orchestra for performing beautiful music during today's ceremony and reception, and to PNC Bank for supporting our reception. And once again, thank you, all of you, for joining us here today. Thank you.